On June 19, 1953, America executed its so-called atom spies. Julius and Ethel Rosenberg were put to death for having stolen the secret of the atomic bomb. The nagging questions surrounding their prosecution, trial, and execution continue to gnaw away at the conscience of many Americans. I am Alvin H. Goldstein. 9 years ago, I produced a documentary report on the case for public television. That report attempted to put the case in contemporary perspective. Because government files on the case were not available in the America of Watergate, that report was necessarily incomplete. Now, a successful Freedom of Information Act lawsuit has forced the government to release a good portion of the Rosenberg files. It seems fitting that 30 years later, we share some of these new findings with the American public. But first, we begin by revisiting the unquiet death of Julius and Ethel Rosenberg.
It is the 19th of June, 1953. At Sing Sing Prison in New York, the government of the United States has just put to death Julius and Ethel Rosenberg. They were said to have stolen the secret of the atomic bomb. Bob Considine, an eyewitness to their execution, files his report.
This was a grim spectacle, kind of a ghastly climax to 2.5 years of demonstration by the American system of jurisprudence that we're willing to give any accused person the ultimate in chances to save his or her neck. These people could have saved themselves up to the last few minutes of their lives. Those curious lives that had started out in the poverty of the Lower East Side here in New York, and which for a time had shown great promise. He was a graduate electrical engineer. She had hoped to be an opera singer. Had a good voice. Became a stenographer, and they were sort of childhood sweethearts. Everything to live for. Couple children, residents in this great country and with all of its opportunities. They died differently, gave off different sounds, different grotesque manners. He died quickly. There didn't seem to be too much life left in him when he entered behind the rabbi. He seemed to be walking in a cadence of steps as if keeping in time with the muttering of the 23rd Psalm. Never said a word. Never looked like he wanted to say a word. She died a lot hotter. When it appeared that she had received enough electricity to kill an ordinary person and had received the exact amount that had killed her husband, the doctors went over and placed the stethoscope to her and looked at each other rather dumbfounded and seemed surprised that she was not dead. And she was given more electricity, which started again the kind of a ghastly plume of smoke that rose from her head. After two more of those jolts, Ethel Rosenberg had met a maker. She'll have a lot of explaining to do.
It is now 20 years since the execution of Julius and Ethel Rosenberg. Perhaps the passion of the 50s is far enough behind us for a dispassionate examination of who they were and who we were. Perhaps it is we who have a lot of explaining to do. In the next 90 minutes, we make inquiry into the unquiet death of Julius and Ethel Rosenberg. It is May 1937. The economic chaos of the Depression leads to strikes and violence. A system of uncontrolled private enterprise shows the evidence of its own bankruptcy. In this America, the Rosenbergs grow to political maturity. With millions of others, they question an economic and political system that lays waste human lives. Capitalism has failed. A new system might be better. Socialism is its name, and for many, the vehicle for change. is the Communist Party. Carl Marzani, then a section leader in the Communist Party.
I was 17 when the Depression began, living in the coal mining areas. My father was a coal miner in Pennsylvania, and we just didn't eat very much. Out of that, the people began to fight. They fought for relief, they fought for unemployment insurance, they fought to organize the trade unions. And in that period, a small group, called themselves communists, who had always believed that the system wasn't functioning, who always believed that you couldn't have political democracy without economic democracy, they took some leadership. I knew Ethel. I left the Communist Party, I should say, by the way, after the German invasion of Russia. And Ethel at that time became my secretary, a volunteer. We had an office on the east side, and I got to know her, of course, quite well. She was a cheerful, lovely, housewife type. I met Julius when she married him, but I knew the types. They were these kind of people around. They were either communists or sympathetic to communists. I don't know, for example, whether the Rosenbergs ever were communists. It's immaterial. They were lefties.
To a government struggling to contain an army of dissidents, the lefties present a threat to established power. At City College in New York, Julius Rosenberg is a student radical. Ethel is a union activist. In May of 1938, the House Un-American Activities Committee is formed. 2 years later, Congress enacts the Smith Act. Americans who work for or advocate radical solutions to the cancer of depression can now be investigated, fined, imprisoned. They are subversives under the law. On New York's Lower East Side, Julius and Ethel Rosenberg are reading The Daily Worker. Ethel's teenage brother, David Greenglass, has joined the Young Communist League. The nation goes to World War II. The Depression is over. The purge of dissidents postponed. The enemy abroad comes first. Julius Rosenberg is employed by the army. Ethel is in civil defense. Her brother, David Greenglass, is a soldier. Winning the war occupies all Americans. Scientists are at work attempting to convert nuclear energy into an atomic bomb. Hiroshima, August 6th, 1945. Nagasaki, August 9th. It is the end of the war, and for some, the end of the world as they knew it. The crew of the Enola Gay, they have delivered America's atomic secret to the world. One of the men who developed and armed the bombs, Dr. Philip Morrison, now co-holder of a patent on the atomic bomb.
Up until December of 38, or the spring of 39, about in that time, nature held from us one terrifying secret. That was the secret of atomic fission. That was discovered and made known to the world by Hahn and Strassmann and then reproduced in all countries in a couple of months in the early part of 1939. And from then on, most physicists who were alert to the times knew that this thing probably contained in it the makings of a terrible bomb, or at least of a source of energy of unprecedented power.
With the end of the war, Americans perceive themselves to be the most powerful nation on Earth, and they begin to act accordingly. The bomb is theirs, and for the moment, theirs alone. Scientists who have built the weapon caution us there are no essential secrets. Russia, indeed any nation that chooses to make the commitment, can do what we have done. Dr. Philip Morrison.
I certainly went to every Rotary Club and businessman's organization and women's club and college class that I could talk to, and I wrote innumerable little, somewhat hackneyed articles by now, repeating pretty much our picture. I think the picture is still true. There was no essential secret, there will be no defense, and the only answer is international peace.
But secrets are useful to post-war America. They are a comforting illusion, a weapon for power politics. There are new enemies abroad and old enemies within. Julius Rosenberg is fired from his government job. They say he was a communist. It is 1946, and a Cold War is moving in from the east. it will freeze the minds of most Americans, including these 11 men and one woman. One day, they are to sit in judgment of Julius and Ethel Rosenberg.
From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent.
I set up the employee loyalty program. I was determined, as far as it was humanly possible, to see that no disloyal person should be employed by our government.
I have never sullied the honor of the American people.
Mr. Chairman,
their goal is the overthrow of our government. There is no doubt as to where a real communist loyalty rests. Their allegiance is to Russia, not the United States.
Are you a member of the Communist Party? Or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
It's unfortunate and tragic that I have to teach this committee the
That's
basic principles of Americanism.
That's not the question.
Are you or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
I believe I have the right to be confronted with any evidence which supports this question. I should like to see what you have.
Oh, well, you would.
Yes.
I don't believe you have the right to answer
well,
the question of anybody.
Are you now or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
It is perfectly clear to me, gentlemen, that if you continue in this particular
fashion,
you have only one
idea,
and that is to cause strife in the industry, chaos in the industry, and
to direct the witness to answer that question.
My bill will publicly identify the communists of this country for the foreign agents that they actually are, and enable both public and private employers to be on guard against them.
The Department of Justice has prosecuted and will continue to prosecute with vigor the actions of subversive groups. A strong America, Mr. Chairman, need have no fear of communism nor of any other alien way of life.
I am holding in my hand a microfilm of very highly confidential secret State Department documents. These documents were fed out of the State Department over 10 years ago by communists who were employees of that department and who were interested in seeing if these documents were sent to the Soviet Union.
It is August 1949. Russia successfully explodes its atomic bomb. The comforting illusion of an atomic secret disappears in a mushroom cloud over Siberia. It is replaced with the concept of atomic theft. And to J. Edgar Hoover, finding the thieves is both a political necessity and a personal crusade. For if the so-called secret of the atomic bomb has been stolen, then it has to have been stolen from under the nose of the FBI. Former FBI agent Richard Brennan.
The pressure was almost unbelievable in some ways, not only from the Bureau of the FBI that we were getting it from, but Mr. Hoover was getting it from outside. He was getting it from Congress. He was getting it in the daily press. The people of the United States had a rude awakening, and they wanted something done about it. Russia would not have had the potential itself to have built an atomic bomb from scratch. In other words, they had to steal it. And we were the only ones who had it. They had to have stolen it from us.
They were bound to find it, anyone who tried. I myself believe that the Soviet, who were not then the tremendous figures in physics that they have become, but were certainly up and coming and full of brilliance, that they would take about 5 years. Well, they took four.
It is February 2nd, 1950. Klaus Fuchs, British physicist, is arrested in England. Fuchs admits passing atom bomb information to an American agent of the Russians during the war in New York, Boston, Santa Fe. May 23rd, 1950. Harry Gold, bachelor chemist from Philadelphia, arrested. Gold says he was the American to whom Klaus Fuchs passed atom bomb information. June 16, 1950. A former Army sergeant stationed at Los Alamos, New Mexico during the war, arrested. His name, David Greenglass. The charge? Passing secret atomic information to the Russians through Harry Gold. July 17, 1950. Julius Rosenberg, brother-in-law of David Greenglass, arrested. J. Edgar Hoover says Rosenberg is another link in Soviet espionage apparatus, which includes Dr. Klaus Fuchs, Harry Gold, David Greenglass. Rosenberg terms the charge fantastic, something like kids here on television. August 11, 1950. Ethel Greenglass Rosenberg, arrested. She, her husband Julius, and her brother David Greenglass are held in $100,000 bond each. August 18, 1950. Morton Sobel, arrested at the Mexican border in Laredo, Texas. Sobel claims he was kidnapped by Mexican secret police. It is less than a year since Russia exploded their atomic bomb. Now these five Americans are in prison, accused of having made it possible. In 6 months, they are to go on trial in the America of Joseph McCarthy. It is March 6, 1951. The Federal Courthouse, Foley Square, New York. A panel of over 300 New Yorkers has been boiled down to 11 men and one woman. These are the jurors in America's atom spy case. They are to enter courtroom 110 and sit in judgment in the case of the people of the United States versus Julius and Ethel Rosenberg and Morton Sobel. The charge, conspiring to commit espionage in wartime. It is the courtroom of Judge Irving R. Kaufman. The government's prosecutors, Irving Sapol in charge. His assistants, Miles Lane, Roy Cohn, James Kilsheimer. Emmanuel Block will defend the Rosenbergs. The voices you are about to hear are actors. The words from the actual trial transcript. Chief Prosecutor Sapol opens.
This case is one of unusual significance. The evidence will show that Sobel and Julius Rosenberg, classmates together in college, dedicated themselves to the cause of communism. This love of communism and the Soviet Union soon led them into a Soviet espionage ring. We will prove that the Rosenbergs devised and put into operation, with the aid of Soviet agents in this country, an elaborate scheme which enabled them to steal through David Greenglass this one weapon which might well hold the key to the survival of this nation, the atomic bomb.
The prosecution's first witness is called Max Ellicher, boyhood friend of Morton Sobel, college classmate of Julius Rosenberg, a former communist. Now fearful of prosecution for having lied on a loyalty oath, he has become a government witness. During the war, he states, when Russia and America were allies, he was visited by Julius Rosenberg. Max Ellicher.
Rosenberg said there were many people who were implementing aid to the Soviet Union by providing classified information about military equipment and asked, would I be able to get such information? He told me that Sobel, who had been my former roommate, was also helping.
Although accusing Rosenberg and Sobel of trying to enlist him in what he calls this espionage business, he admits on cross-examination he never passed any information to either of them. Next for the prosecution, David Greenglass. He is Ethel Rosenberg's brother. When arrested, he pleaded guilty. The government postpones his sentence until after the trial of his sister and brother-in-law. In 1944, he was an Army machinist stationed at Los Alamos, New Mexico. While on furlough in New York, he says, he drew a sketch for Rosenberg of a high-explosive lens mold he worked on at Los Alamos. He tells that Rosenberg said he would send someone to Los Alamos to pick up more atomic information in the future. He said Rosenberg cut a jello box in two pieces to identify the courier. The green glasses were to keep one half, the courier would present the other. On a Sunday morning, June 3rd, 1945, he says, Harry Gold knocked at the door of the Greenglass apartment in New Mexico. David Greenglass.
He asked if I were Mr. Greenglass, and I said yes. He stepped through the door, and he said, Julius sent me. I walked to my wife's purse and took out the part of the jello box. Gold produced his piece, and we checked them, and they fitted.
Greenglass says he gave Gold two more lens mold sketches and written data. Prosecutor Roy Cohn.
Did you at a later time give Rosenberg a description of the atom bomb itself?
I did. In September 1945, when I was again on furlough in New York, I drew up a sketch of the atom bomb and prepared about 12 pages of written material. Julius read it and he said, "This is very good. We got to have this typed up immediately."
Who did the typing, Mr. Greenglass?
Ethel did the typing.
After the arrests of Fuchs and Gold, Rosenberg urged him to flee the country, he says. Rosenberg told him to have passport pictures taken and gave him an escape route. Ruth Greenglass, although a co-conspirator with her husband David, is not indicted. She appears as a government witness. She supports her husband's story in all essentials. Now Harry Gold takes the witness stand, the self-confessed courier for Klaus Fuchs. He had been sentenced to 30 years earlier. He is not a defendant in the Rosenberg-Sabell case. He is a government witness. Gold says that in spring 1945, his Russian espionage superior, Anatoly Yakovlev, told him to pick up information in New Mexico. Harry Gold.
Yakovlev gave me a sheet of paper on which was typed the name Greenglass, an address in Albuquerque, and the words, "Recognition signal, I come from Julius." Yakovlev also gave me a piece of cardboard which appeared to have been cut from a packaged food of some sort. It was cut in an odd shape, and Yakovlev told me that the man Greenglass, whom I would meet in Albuquerque, would have the matching piece of cardboard.
He says when he arrived in Albuquerque on a Saturday night, he found that the Greenglasses were not at home. Harry Gold.
I stayed that night. I finally managed to obtain a room in a hallway of a rooming house. And then, on Sunday morning, June 3rd, I registered at the Hotel Hilton under my own name.
He says he returned to the Greenglass apartment early Sunday morning. Harry Gold.
I knocked on a door. It was opened by a young man of about 23. I said, "Mr. Greenglass?" He answered in the affirmative. I said, "I came from Julius," and I showed him the piece of cardboard. Greenglass went to a woman's handbag and brought out from it a piece of cardboard. We matched the two of them. Greenglass told me that he would have the material on the atom bomb ready for me that afternoon.
He returned, Gold says, took the atom bomb information, and started back east. 2 days later, he says, he gave the information to Yakovlev, the Russian, in New York. Emanuel Bloch does not cross-examine or challenge Gold's testimony. The government presents a copy of a registration card from the Albuquerque Hilton Hotel. It has the name Harry Gold, the date June 3rd, 1945. A total of 23 witnesses testify for the prosecution, but only four, Ellicher, the Greenglasses, and Gold, give evidence directly related to the alleged crime of conspiracy. Julius Rosenberg is called to the stand. Emanuel Bloch questions him on the matter of the Jell-O box.
Did you ever have any transaction with the Greenglasses in which a Jell-O box was involved?
No, I did not.
Did you cut any side of a Jell-O box at any time?
I did not.
Did any such incident ever take place?
It never did.
Did your wife ever type any material for transmission to the Soviet Union?
She did not.
Did you ever receive from David or Ruth Greenglass any information or any sketches concerning the Los Alamos project?
I did not.
Did you ever ask him or Ruth to get you such information?
I never asked them.
Now Ethel Rosenberg takes the stand. She too swears the testimony of her brother and sister-in-law to be false. She reveals that the Greenglasses were jealous of them and angry about money they lost in business with Julius. On cross-examination, the Rosenbergs refuse to answer questions concerning their political beliefs. They insist upon their innocence. Morton Sabell is implicated by a single individual, Max Ellicher. The prosecution further implicates Sabell in connection with a trip he took to Mexico in June 1950 and his use of aliases there. Morton Sabell does not testify. He pleads not guilty. Defense attorney Bloch sums up. He asserts the case against the Rosenbergs depends upon oral evidence only. There is, he says, no documentary evidence that ties the Rosenbergs to espionage. Emanuel Bloch.
Put yourself, if you can, in that defendant's box and ask yourselves, if my brother or my sister or my child were sitting in that defendant's box, would I convict them on this kind of testimony? That's all I ask you to do. And I say, if you do that, you can come to no other conclusion than that these defendants are innocent, and you are going to show to the world that in America a man can get a fair trial.
Prosecutor Sapol sums up for the government.
The history of this jello box side, the greetings from Julius, and Greenglass's whereabouts in Albuquerque come to us not only from Ruth and David, but from Harry Gold. Harry Gold, who furnished the absolute corroboration of the testimony of the Greenglasses, forged the necessary link in the chain that points indisputably to the guilt of the Rosenbergs. We know that these conspirators stole the most important secrets ever known to mankind and delivered them to the Soviet Union. No defendants ever stood before the bar of American justice less deserving of sympathy than these three.
To the jurors now belongs the verdict. The 11 men and one woman have listened for 14 days. They are to deliberate for 8 hours and 45 minutes. Now the jury foreman announces the verdict. Vincent Labinette.
We find the defendant Julius Rosenberg guilty as charged. We find the defendant Ethel Rosenberg guilty as charged. We find the defendant Morton Sobel guilty as charged.
It is April 6th, 1951. Judge Irving R. Kaufman sentences David Greenglass to 15 years in prison. He acknowledges his cooperation with the government. The day before, Morton Sobel had been given the maximum prison sentence, 30 years. Julius and Ethel Rosenberg face Judge Kaufman.
The issue of punishment in this case is presented in a unique framework of history. It is so difficult to make people realize that this country is engaged in a life and death struggle with a completely different system. I consider your crime worse than murder. I believe your conduct in putting into the hands of the Russians the A-bomb years before our best scientists predicted Russia would perfect the bomb has already caused, in my opinion, the communist aggression in Korea, with the resultant casualties exceeding 50,000. And who knows but that millions more of innocent people may pay the price of your treason. Indeed, by your betrayal, you undoubtedly have altered the course of history to the disadvantage of our country. We have evidence of your treachery all around us every day. The civilian defense activities throughout the nation are aimed at preparing us for an atom bomb attack. It is not in my power, Julius and Ethel Rosenberg, to forgive you. You are hereby sentenced to the punishment of death.
Did you cut any side of the jello box at any time?
I did not.
Would I be able
we will
to get
prove that the Rosenbergs devised...
He told me that Sobel was also helping.
Who did the typing, Mr. Green?
Ethel did the typing.
Recognition signal, I come from Julius.
Put yourself, if you can, in that defendant's box and ask yourself...
the most important secrets ever known to mankind...
I did not.
...and delivered them to the Soviet Union.
Time has not stilled the voices of the past. It is thousands of pages of court records and millions of words and dozens of books later. With the passage of 20 years, the shroud of doubt surrounding the Rosenberg-Sobel case hangs even heavier in the America of Watergate. Perhaps because our tolerance for the excesses of government has worn thin. Perhaps because they were the first and only Americans ever put to death for espionage in our civil court history. To some, the punishment seemed not to fit the crime. To others, there has always been room for a reasonable doubt. Victims or traitors? To former prosecutor Roy Cohn, there has never been a question.
How were we on the prosecution staff so certain of the Rosenbergs' guilt? We were so certain of it because the immutable evidence is confirmed by a long series of circumstances and independent corroboration made this one of the most overwhelmingly proved cases there ever was. You had this perfect chain that led from Fuchs to Gold to the Greenglasses, and the Greenglasses led to, inevitably, to Julius and Ethel Rosenberg.
But the perfect chain may have had an imperfect link in the person of Harry Gold. The 40-year-old bachelor chemist claimed to have been the man to whom Klaus Fuchs passed atomic information. In the Rosenberg case, Gold's believability as a key government witness rested on the assumption that Klaus Fuchs had indeed identified him. But Fuchs had originally twice failed to make an identification of gold from FBI photographs and film. Former FBI agent Robert Lamphere remembers his third attempt to get Fuchs to identify gold.
As it was being shown, I watched him and not the film. And again, he was expressionless, made no comment until the film was concluded and the lights were back on. And I turned to him again and said, "Can you identify that man?" And he paused and said, yes, that was my American contact.
Some years later, Klaus Fuchs was visited in prison by a member of the British Parliament and two American lawyers. Marshall Perlin was one.
One of the prime questions was gold the courier? Did Fuchs ever identify gold as the courier? And the clear and unequivocal evidence that came out of Fuchs' mouth was no, he never identified gold as the courier, either to the FBI, British intelligence, or to his attorneys.
That is absolutely not what happened. It was a representative of MI5 there. There was an assistant director of the FBI there, and I was there. And what happened is what I've related to you.
He told us how they kept on importuning him to identify them, saying, "For God's sakes, say he's the man. Gold insists he is." British intelligence said the same thing. His attorney said the same thing. And Fuchs says, if he wants to be the man, so be it. He's the man. But there was never, in fact, an identification of gold by Fuchs.
Was Harry Gold the man to whom Klaus Fuchs gave atomic information? In 1950, Fuchs gave British authorities a written confession. Perhaps it contains the answer. But this confession remains secret in England, despite our repeated efforts to have it made public. As for Klaus Fuchs, he served 9 years in a British prison. We found him in Dresden, East Germany. Today, he works at the Institute for Atomic Physics. He chose not to discuss the matter. Perhaps the most exhaustive investigation into the testimony of Harry Gold in recent times is this current book. The authors, Miriam and Walter Schneer, devoted 5 years to their study. Miriam Schneer.
Harry Gold was the key corroborative witness in the Rosenberg-Sobel trial. It was his testimony that formed what Prosecutor Sapol called the necessary link in the chain of evidence. Now, why was Gold's testimony necessary? The reason was that he provided the connection between Greenglass and the Russians. It was Harry Gold who supposedly had the other half of the jello box, which was last seen in the hand of Julius Rosenberg, and which Harry said he obtained from his Russian associate. So therefore, his testimony was absolutely necessary to provide the connection between the Rosenbergs and alleged Russian agents.
It was really vital to the government's case that Harry Gold be established as having been in Albuquerque on June 3, 1945, the day of the alleged jello box top meeting. And in order to establish this, they had the testimony of Gold that he was in Albuquerque, and they had the testimony of the Greenglasses.
In addition, there were a couple of items of documentary evidence. And the most important one of these was the registration card from the Hilton Hotel in Albuquerque, made out on the face of it, June 3, 1945. But when we looked at the actual exhibit, a photostatic copy of this card that the prosecution entered in evidence at the trial, we discovered that it contained a very serious error, and that error was in the date timestamp. The date timestamp on the reverse side of the card read June 4, 1945. And when we queried employees of the Hilton Hotel in Albuquerque about the stamp, they said that the date of the stamp would govern. Therefore, the card never proved what it was supposed to prove. It never proved that Harry Gold was in Albuquerque on the date of that alleged meeting.
In any case, on the basis of our research, we came to the conclusion that this piece of evidence was a forgery. When an effort was made to try to find the original of the card, and this effort was made as part of a court proceeding just within the last 5 or 6 years. And J. Edgar Hoover was queried and asked, please produce the original of this card so that it can be examined by document examiners for ink and paper and aging and so on. He wrote back and said, due to the passage of time, this card is no longer available.
In the course of our research, we had one really fantastic break, and that was that Harry Gold, through his attorney, gave us access to pre-trial statements that he had made.
The voice you're about to hear is that of Harry Gold, from tapes obtained by the Schneers. Gold's Russian contact was said to be Anatoly Yakovlev, also known as John. Gold said he delivered to Yakovlev the atomic information he picked up from a man in New Mexico, later identified as David Greenglass. Now, Gold describes Yakovlev's reaction to the information and the man. The time, mid-June 1950, 9 months before the Rosenberg trial. The actual voice of Harry Gold.
I turned the information over to John. John never mentioned anything about it. And on the one occasion when I did mention this man, sometime in the late fall of 1945, John had said that we could forget all about him, that there wasn't much point in getting in touch with him. And I got from the manner in which he made the remark that apparently the information received had not been of very much consequence at all.
Now, here is Harry Gold's trial testimony on the same incident 9 months later. The voice is an actor.
Yakovlev told me that the information that I had given him had been sent immediately to the Soviet Union. He said that the information which I had received from Greenglass was extremely excellent and very valuable.
Information that had not been of very much consequence 9 months earlier had become extremely excellent and very valuable at the Rosenberg trial. Clearly, Harry Gold's account had changed dramatically. It was never documented that Julius Rosenberg had any contact at any time with any Russians. The only link between Rosenberg and Yakovlev the Russian was provided by Harry Gold. A jello box top and a password, I came from Julius. Here is Harry Gold's testimony from the Rosenberg trial transcript. The voice is an actor.
I knocked on a door. It was opened by a young man of about 23. I said, Mr. Greenglass? He answered in the affirmative. I said, I came from Julius.
Here is how Gold described the same password 9 months earlier. The actual voice of Harry Gold.
I believe that it involved the name of a man and was something on the order of Bob sent me or Benny sent me or John sent me or something like that.
How did the names Bob or Benny or John evolve into Julius? Former FBI agent Richard Brennan recalls an interview with Harry Gold before the Rosenberg trial.
He used the expression, Benny sent me, which was the best that he could recall at the time. Subsequently, when the trail of Greenglass led to Rosenberg, we asked him, Miller and myself, or one or the other, could it have been Julie sent me or Julius sent me? And immediately he brightened up with a great light. Yes, that is it. It wasn't Benny. It was Julius sent me.
Now, is it normal procedure to suggest a name to somebody you're interviewing?
On something like that, it was not wrong as such. We didn't plant that idea in Gold's mind. Actually, you couldn't plant an idea in his mind. It was given to him as a suggestion.
We concluded on the basis of all of the information about Harry Gold, which we collected in our years of research, that the June 3 Albuquerque incident never occurred, that Harry Gold never met with the Greenglasses at their apartment in Albuquerque, never received information from David Greenglass, never bore a jello box top, never gave greetings from Julius, and never transferred information from the Greenglasses to his Soviet contact.
I don't think the doubt is from responsible sources. The doubt seems to come from people like the people named the Schneers, who wrote a book called Invitation to an Inquest, supposedly objective, but failed to speak to one person who was connected with the prosecution.
We spoke with 112 persons connected with the Rosenberg-Sobel case, dozens of whom represented the government's position. Of the prosecutors, only two, Roy Cohn and James Kilsheimer, agreed to interviews. What is the truth behind Harry Gold's testimony? The answer may be buried in the files of the FBI. For 6 months, we have sought to gain access to these files. Although promised, none have been released to us. As for Harry Gold, we found him in a Philadelphia cemetery, 7 years after he was released from prison. He left behind a lengthy, convoluted rebuttal to the Schneers and others, and a characterization by his last employer. Harry Gold was a gentle man who had difficulty separating fantasy from reality. The government claimed the Rosenbergs were Soviet spies. The government chose to prosecute the Rosenbergs for conspiring to commit espionage rather than for having committed espionage. By using conspiracy, the government gained the advantage of never having to prove a substantive crime actually took place. The government's conspiracy case against the Rosenbergs depended almost solely on the testimony of David and Ruth Greenglass. Beyond Harry Gold, there was little or no corroborative support for their testimony. Gloria Agron, assistant to Emanuel Block, the Rosenberg defense lawyer.
It was really the word of the Greenglasses against the word of the Rosenbergs. The way that the conspiracy law under federal statutes works is that the unsupported word of one person is adequate without any confirmatory evidence. This conviction could not have stood in a state court like the New York state courts, because there you have to have at least two witnesses to the same act or corroborating evidence. The government, the United States government, is free of this. In a case that's a capital case, I think they have an obligation to go beyond this.
David Greenglass had stolen a piece of uranium from Los Alamos during the war, apparently as a souvenir. In early 1950, the FBI questioned him about the theft. He denied it. In June 1950, FBI agents questioned Greenglass again. This time, they accused him of passing atomic information. After 12 hours of questioning, Greenglass confessed to espionage. He was told he faced a possible death penalty. He was urged to name others. Former FBI agent John Lewis.
While interviewing David Greenglass, I asked him who had recruited him into Soviet espionage. He hesitated for a while, and then he said, well, John, I know you'll find out anyway. There's no use to me playing cat and mouse with you. I might as well tell you. It was my brother-in-law, Julius Rosenberg, and his wife, my sister, Ethel Rosenberg, that first recruited me.
To seek to prove that the Rosenbergs were in fact involved in espionage, the government had to have the cooperation of David and Ruth Greenglass. How had the Greenglasses come to provide the testimony that convicted their sister and brother-in-law? The Greenglasses' lawyer, O. John Rogge.
I would say at about the third session with Ruth, as I outlined to her the possibilities. One was the right to remain silent, but I had to add that David's already talked. Another one was to go to the government and see what consideration I could get for making them government witnesses. And I remember Ruth's response very well. It was, what are we waiting for? Then I said to her, well, I've already started it. I felt that I had an arrangement with the government whereby, for providing the government with witnesses, namely Ruth and David Greenglass, that Ruth would be left out of the indictment, and she was, and that David would have a sentence of no more than 3 to 5 years. But when it came to judgment day, the judge wrapped himself in the flag, went overboard, and began with death penalties.
David Greenglass was sentenced to 15 years in prison. He served 10. Many of the unanswered questions that contribute to the doubt surrounding this case grow out of the Greenglass's testimony and the role the government had in its development. The FBI files in the green glasses could contain the answers that might settle that doubt. We sought to have those files made public. We were told they would be made available. That was 3 months ago. Now we are told to protect the green glasses, the files are to remain closed. What of David and Ruth Greenglass? We found them, living in this house. They've taken new names. They chose not to talk with us about their role in the government's case against Julius and Ethel Rosenberg. For these 12 Americans in 1951, the choice was ultimately not what is the evidence, but whom do you believe, Julius and Ethel Rosenberg, or the government of the United States? Like most in the America of Joseph McCarthy, these jurors chose to believe the government's witnesses.
I would say Harry Gold had what is known as an eidetic memory. He could remember detail, dates, descriptions, right to the nth degree.
Well, I think Greenglass was believable, and I based that opinion on the fact that he already had pleaded guilty, and I think he was just trying to make a deal with the government to get a lenient sentence.
Here is a brother really trying to put his sister in a hole. All I thought of, well, this fella's telling the truth to save his own skin, as it were, and that of his wife's, because she was a witness also, she corroborated his testimony almost word for word, and as hard as they tried to break it down, they couldn't do it.
The jurors in America's Adam Spy case. We found 9 who are known to be alive today. 5 agreed to appear. Who were these jurors? They were all remarkably similar in background, education, employment, and what they read, and what they had learned.
I feel about treason pretty much the same way that I feel about murder, rape, kidnapping, which includes hijacking. I think the maximum penalty should be imposed.
During my younger days, the idea of a communist connoted something evil or dirty. It was a dirty word, actually.
It was very, very important that we try to keep these secrets to our own government. We were the ones who perfected it. And anybody that wanted to release these to any government, regardless of who it was treasonous. Mm-hmm. And we thought at the time that it was. I still think it would be.
It was right after World War II, relatively short time after. The Korean War was going on, and communism was communism. It was a bad thing. After all, we'd helped them in World War II, bailed them out, and here they are, coming back at us any way they could, taking over all these European nations and making slave states out of them. So I think the feeling against communism was much more prevalent then than it is today.
They had been systematically selected from an original list of over 300 prospective jurors. The prosecution, but not the defense, had access to FBI reports on each. Carefully excluded were all Jews, in a city with one-third Jewish population, all liberals in a city known for its liberalism, all readers of any but the most conservative publications in a city with a wide and varied press. They were a jury of the Rosenbergs' neighbors, but not their peers. Morton Sabell, the almost forgotten man in the Rosenberg-Sabell case. The prosecutors included him in the conspiracy indictment because they sought to demonstrate that the Rosenbergs were the center of an espionage ring. Sobel had not been accused of stealing atomic secrets. His crime may have been little more than once having known Julius Rosenberg and in choosing the wrong time for a trip to Mexico. The only person testifying against Sobel was his former roommate and friend, Max Ellicher. No one else supported Ellicher's testimony. Ellicher stated that on several occasions, Sobel talked to him about espionage, and that on one occasion he saw Sobel visit Rosenberg. Ellicher faced a perjury charge before he became a government witness. After he testified, He was never indicted. Morton Sabell spent 18 and a half years in prisons, 5 1/2 in Alcatraz. He never took the witness stand in his own defense. Morton Sabell.
I didn't feel angry when I heard Max Ellicher lie during the trial. In fact, I pitied him because I knew him to be a weak person, and I blamed myself in a sense for having associated with him, knowing him to be what he was.
Why didn't you take the witness stand during your trial?
If I took the stand and the prosecutor were to ask me about my Communist Party affiliations, that in the eyes of the jury at that time, if I were to admit having been a member of the Communist Party, that this by itself would be enough to convict me of espionage. And in addition to the question of the Communist Party membership, the other point the government would murder me with was on the question of my trip to Mexico. Initially, when we went to Mexico, there was no question of flight. It was while in Mexico that the Korean War started. Julius was arrested, Ethel was arrested, that we became frightened in view of all these events, and that the matter of flight really arose. This fright led me to do foolish things like using pseudonyms when I traveled around Mexico looking for a way out. The FBI got the Mexican security police to kidnap us fairly brutally. I still have a crack in my skull. And take us back to the States.
He was not kidnapped, in my opinion. He was apprehended by the Mexican police, and they brought him to the border and kicked him out of their country.
Originally, when I was arrested, I had not been indicted. And as a matter of fact, I was not indicted for several months later. It was during this period that they tried to get me to become a witness against Julius and Ethel. The first thing the government agents, the FBI, told me the following morning, when they met me, was, did I know that I faced the death penalty? And they kept telling me that I would face the electric chair if I did not cooperate.
I told him that in the event he cooperated with the United States government, that we would certainly bring to the attention of the proper authorities his cooperation so that it could be taken into consideration in disposing of his case.
To me, the thought of cooperating with the government, that is to perjure oneself and accuse an innocent person in order to save one's own skin, the thought I find so horrendous that it is entirely foreign to my thinking.
I consider your crime worse than murder. I believe your conduct in putting into the hands of the Russians the A-bomb years before our best scientists predicted Russia would perfect the bomb has already caused, in my opinion, the communist aggression in Korea, with the resultant casualties exceeding 50,000. And who knows but that millions more of innocent people may pay the price of your treason.
Julius and Ethel Rosenberg were put to death for having stolen the secret of the atomic bomb. Was there ever a secret to be stolen? The co-holder of a patent on the atomic bomb, one of the scientists who developed and armed the weapon, Dr. Philip Morrison.
The superiority was based only on having been there first. They said this is the secret of the atomic bomb, but I say it is far from that. There is no great secret of the atomic bomb. This is a crude caricature of the structure of one particular model, without enough detail to make it possible to reproduce or even to understand as it was drawn, since it contains some errors. What more could you expect from a man who was himself very little training with a high school education and no direct contact at that time whatever with any but the simple mechanical parts that he might have seen as he worked in the shop where he made the lens molds?
What are lens molds? Are they secret?
Well, I think it's an important technical device. And an experienced person in high explosive work will understand that lenses are a natural thing to try, and I think they would get it out. Now, maybe that hint of one word is worth something. I think probably it is. It's, especially since the Americans have succeeded, then perhaps it tells you which way to go. And I would not say it is a worthless piece of information, but to call it a secret of the atomic bomb is a vast exaggeration, a dramatic, eloquent exaggeration. From 1945 on, there is certainly no atomic secret. The secret is out. Fission will make it work. There are thousands of little secrets. How do I do this? How do I do that? But there are 60 ways to do every one of them. Obviously, I do not myself know how every part of this thing is made and works, though I think I was pretty intimate with it. It's just too much for one man to know, too much for one book to tell, too much to write on any piece of paper. Volumes of technical skill, laboratories full of people, factories, machinists, machines, all sorts of things. That's what it takes. It's an industry, not a recipe.
They were the first and only Americans ever put to death for espionage in our civil court history. If there was no secret to the atomic bomb, then what was their crime?
In the face of the Korean War, in the face of the loss of atomic bomb superiority, the fact that here were people could be found who perhaps had made this whole thing possible, give a simplified answer by saying they had given away a secret, made sense to a lot of people. It gave them some feeling that there was something they could fight and something they could oppose, and made a kind of national unity in which were lost many of the values and almost the peace itself.
In my judgment, if the Rosenbergs had been willing to tell what they knew about Russian espionage, we would have had the most gigantic espionage case in the history of this country.
Well, this is a case that involved great feeling. And I suppose there are people who look upon this as a political case. I don't. To my mind, there wasn't any doubt from the very beginning that this was an espionage case and was not a political case, wasn't a civil rights case, wasn't a civil liberties case. It was espionage.
And I think this case basically is a fraud and a frame-up.
If it had been a frame-up, which it was not, it would have had to have been a very gigantic conspiracy.
Very often when a frame-up is done, it isn't done on a mass scale and involves a whole host of people on just the entire matter. Little bits of evidence, quote, get developed. And possibly the last person to receive the evidence might believe it's true, although the donor of that evidence might know it's false.
And it was a case that was very much desired. It was a case which could prove the connections between communists and espionage and a desire to aid the enemy, the Cold War enemy.
It didn't follow that every American communist was a spy or an enemy. However, a devoted communist, his idea is he's devoted to the principle of overthrowing this government by force and violence.
In and around 1950, the department perceived the Communist Party in the United States to be an extension of Soviet communism.
If you take Julie and Ethel, for instance, their idea of communism was to make a better world for all the poor people, of which they were too.
I think I approached the Rosenberg case and these others from a somewhat objective, standpoint, and I don't think I was swayed by the communist menace. It was an espionage case against specific people based upon specific facts.
That these people did not feel themselves participating in a frame of, any more than the Watergate people felt that they were participating in a burglary. The Watergate people felt that they were participating in an act of patriotism to keep the Democrats out of the White House. These people felt that they were participating in an act of patriotism to awaken the American people to the dangers of communism.
When a government seeks to repress a certain group of ideas, it will go beyond the pale of what is legal and justifiable in order to accomplish the end.
The evidence has stood the test of time, so...
The children of Julius and Ethel Rosenberg. Robert was 6 when his parents were put to death. Michael was 10. Today they bear the names of their adopted parents. Michael Mirapol.
I think the most important thing is, first of all, that they were innocent, the victim of a tremendous political frame-up. I mean, you have to start from that reference point if you're talking to us. I mean, that's obviously our point of view. and we firmly believe that. And they were placed in a position where they really didn't have any choice. It was a kind of a thing that, you know, the courage was summoned up once they were in the death house and waiting out those 3 years. Then the courage was really the courage to stay sane. I think that's the issue that they were lucid to the end, that they, you know, very quietly and with dignity, held to the truth. I mean, the issue that they refused to lie at the beginning, I don't think that's particularly extraordinary. I think that's, you know, what people should do.
When I think about them, I think of the interactions I remember. A few prison visits, and a couple of basic memory flashes of one specific event, say, that would occur in the apartment. I mean, just one or two things. Basically, all I get is a general feeling of warmth.
But we are, basically, aside from the people who are dead now, we are the injured parties. I mean, we had our parents taken away from us, and it created a lot of problems for us in our lives, and we still feel that loss. I mean, that is a loss that we still feel, and every time I read the letters, and every time I follow the last day, I keep rooting for the Supreme Court to support Justice Douglas, but it never does.
It is June 15th, 1953. The Supreme Court of the United States, in a 5-4 decision, has denied a final review of the Rosenberg case. For over 2 years, Emanuel Bloch has gone from court to court, from judge to judge, pleading his case. 15 times he had lost. Because of federal practice, no appeals court had ever reviewed the testimony or the reliability of the witnesses or the evidence. Only the original trial judge or the president could change the sentence. Harry Truman has left the presidency and the problem to Dwight David Eisenhower. In response to worldwide appeals for clemency, Attorney General Brownell had sent prisons director James Bennett to Sing Sing. He carried the hope of a stay of execution in exchange for a full confession. The Rosenbergs had answered, "By asking us to repudiate the truth of our innocence, the government admits its own doubts concerning our guilt. We will not help purify the foul record of a fraudulent conviction and a barbaric sentence. Our respect for truth, conscience, and human dignity is not for sale. History will record, whether we live or not, that we were victims of the most monstrous frame-up in the history of our country." It is June 16th. As Justice Douglas prepares to leave for vacation, he is approached by two newcomers to the case, Fike Farmer and Daniel Marshall. They argue that the Rosenbergs were tried under the wrong law. They say the Rosenbergs should have been tried under the Atomic Energy Act of 1946. Had they been, the present death sentence would have been illegal. Justice Douglas considers the arguments. He remains in Washington studying the briefs into the night. It is Wednesday morning, June 17th. Justice Douglas has decided the argument has merit. He grants a stay of execution. The Rosenbergs will live, at least until the court reconvenes in October. Gloria Agron, attorney and assistant to Emanuel Bloch.
I remember sitting in the Supreme Court building in the evening that the Douglas stay came down. Or the day before, it came down in the morning. It was probably the only good day we had in the entire Rosenberg case. There was a sense of tremendous release, even though it would have meant to us that they lived only until the October term of the Supreme Court. But that was not tomorrow. That was October, and this was June.
The stay of execution brings to Washington one of the Rosenberg prosecutors, James Kilsheimer. He comes to urge Attorney General Brownell to fight the stay.
I think that if the death penalty was ever warranted for any crime, it was warranted in this case. I was somewhat distressed because I knew that this would lead to another series of appeals which would delay the case for months. The United States was taking a terrible propaganda bath in the press, both here and abroad. And the case had, in our opinion, been fully reviewed.
Within hours of the Douglas decision, Attorney General Brownell requests a special Supreme Court session. The move reflects Brownell's resolve to proceed with the executions. Chief Justice Vincent complies. He calls the justices back from vacation. Gloria Agron.
And then we started running again. We went back to work on our second petition for clemency. We went back to work on the papers that on which Justice Douglas had ruled. We tried to create papers on new legal issues. I don't know whether they were good or bad, but they were new ones. We had to have something to go in with. And that was into the dawn.
Thursday, June 18th, the Supreme Court is reconvened in an extraordinary session. Outside, the press awaits a decision. At Sing Sing Prison in New York, preparations for the executions proceed in the event the stay is vacated. At 6:29 p.m., the court recesses until the next day. In Toms River, New Jersey, the children of Julius and Ethel Rosenberg wonder at the ways of the world. Friday morning, June 19th. At the White House, the Rosenberg case is discussed at a cabinet meeting. Emmett John Hughes, the president's assistant, recalls an exchange between Attorney General Brownell and Eisenhower. The president said he was impressed by the honest doubts expressed in the letters he'd seen. If the Supreme Court decides by 5-4, or even 6-3, he says to Brownell, then as far as the average man's concerned, there will be doubt. Brownell responds, well, who's going to decide these points? Pressure groups or the Supreme Court? He tells Eisenhower there was evidence that wasn't usable in court, showing the Rosenbergs were the head and center of an espionage ring in direct contact with the Russians. Noontime Friday, the fate of the Rosenbergs is in the hands of the special court session. The vote is announced. It is 6-3. By two votes, Douglas's stay has been overruled. The Rosenbergs will die in 11 hours. The majority decision seems to urge executive clemency, at least to Emanuel Block.
I'm now reading from Mr. Justice Jackson's opinion. Vacating this stay is not to be construed as endorsing the wisdom or appropriateness to this case of a death sentence. Needless to say, the three judges who voted for us were obviously appalled by the death sentence. So that you have nine judges of the Supreme Court who are questioning the death sentence here.
At Sing Sing, preparations continue for the executions. In cities across America and beyond, hundreds of thousands gather in silent protest. 11 o'clock is 6 hours away. All eyes turn toward the White House. The president responds. White House Press Secretary Murray Snyder.
The following is part of a statement just issued by the President of the United States. I am not unmindful of the fact that this case has aroused grave concern both here and abroad in the minds of serious people aside from the considerations of law. In this connection, I can only say that by immeasurably increasing the chances of atomic war, the Rosenbergs may have condemned to death tens of millions of innocent people all over the world. I will not intervene in this matter.
Well, we called the president, and we were not to be put through to him, but to one of his secretaries. And we hung on the line for almost 35 minutes with no one on the line, not a secretary, not an operator. We called back, and we hung on the line again for a half an hour. And obviously, we knew no one wanted to talk to us.
On 17th Street in New York, thousands gather for a final protest. One of the organizers, Emily Allman, remembers.
We did not expect the execution to take place. The day before we had gotten the stay, we had arranged to have a public meeting on the 19th to celebrate the fact that they would be alive. When we learned that morning that they were going to be executed, the sense of disbelief was enormous. We were there, we spoke, we kept waiting and hoping to hear that the sentence had been commuted.
At Sing Sing, David Rosenberg is denied a final visit with his brother Julius. 11 o'clock is 5 hours away.
At one point, we did convey to Brownell that this was the Jewish Sabbath, and that the execution should not be on the Sabbath. Not, I believe, that anyone of us was religious, nor do I think that the Rosenbergs were religious in that sense, but just because time was life and it was important. Well, I guess Brownell understood that too, because the word we got that he would do it before the sunset.
Now, the execution will be at 8 o'clock. It is 2 hours away. At Sing Sing, an open telephone line connects to J. Edgar Hoover's office in Washington. On 17th Street in New York, the crowd swells. Emily Allman.
Time, in a very real sense, as it does in many occasions when you're under this tension, sort of expanded. Every minute became a long time. A terrible sense of sorrow. Terrible sense of grief, which we were sharing. I think most of the crowd felt that it could have been any one of us.
In Washington, in J. Edgar Hoover's office, they wait for word on the open line from Sing Sing. The Rosenbergs have been told for the last time that if they speak out, they might get a stay. At Sing Sing, the only response is the voice of Rabbi Irving Koslow reading the 23rd Psalm as Julius Rosenberg follows silently into the death chamber. Inside the White House, the president is preparing for dinner. Outside, Morton Sobel's wife, Helen, ends her 2-year struggle to save the Rosenbergs. 3 blocks away, at the Statler Hilton Hotel, Gloria Agron and Emmanuel Block answer a phone call.
And then just as it was getting to be 8 o'clock, we got a phone call from New York saying the executions have begun. We never heard it on television. We turned it off. And I think all that existed afterwards was silence and a blood-red sun.
It was the poet-philosopher Santayana who said, "Those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it."
The report you have just seen was first telecast in 1974. At that time, no government files related to the Rosenberg case were available. In the ensuing years, almost 350,000 pages of FBI and other documents have now been pried loose from the government as a result of a number of lawsuits. Historians and journalists, seeking to settle some of the vexing questions this case has raised, have pored over this material, looking for some incontrovertible evidence, either supporting the government's case or justifying the Rosenbergs' contention of innocence. For the most part, these files are filled with the minutiae of hearsay FBI investigation. They neither confirm nor deny the guilt or innocence of the Rosenbergs and Morton Sobel. They seem to reveal more about government manipulation of our justice system than about justice itself. Now, 2 new books are about to be released. They seek to interpret these files in comprehensive detail. Their authors, often reading the very same material, form somewhat different conclusions. Ronald Radosh, with his co-author Joyce Milton, conclude the government had a solid case. Walter and Miriam Schneer find the files reinforce their contention that the Rosenbergs were tried for crimes they never committed. Although the Rosenbergs were convicted of planning to commit espionage, they were, in popular terms, said to have stolen the secret of the atomic bomb. Their death sentence was based upon the effect such a lost secret had upon our nation. The files now further confirm the government always knew there never was such a vital secret for the Rosenbergs to steal. Walter and Miriam Schneer.
We found in the files that a piece of material that had never been revealed before from the Oppenheimer hearings. In 1954, the year after the execution of the Rosenbergs, J. Robert Oppenheimer was tried in a security proceeding. And at those hearings, many famous scientists testified, leaders of the atomic project and so on. One of them was General Leslie Groves, who had been the man who was in charge of the entire Manhattan Project. And he suddenly let the cat out of the bag because he testified that the information that was given in the Rosenberg case was really not of very much importance at all. And then he suddenly said, but I wouldn't want that to get out because I think that in any event, the Rosenbergs deserve to hang.
Now, this testimony of General Groves was suppressed for decades, but it's clear in reading the files that people at the top levels of government were well aware that Groves and others did not believe that the information the Rosenbergs were alleged to have given was of any great significance whatsoever.
And the reason for this is also in the files, the incredible documents we found that Klaus Fuchs, the famous German-born Manhattan Project scientist, had earlier, before the Greenglass information, had given in its most complete detail possible every theoretical discovery pertaining to the implosion process, that he had given this to the Russians, not only in written detail, but along with highly accurate sketches of the process for manufacturing the atomic bomb. The government knew this when they tried the Rosenbergs. J. Edgar Hoover knew this. And one of the documents we found is a message from J. Edgar Hoover to FBI agents in San Francisco, where he tells them point blank, the Russians were working on atomic energy themselves, and that it is rather ridiculous to think that the developments made by the Russians only came from the Rosenbergs. The government knew this, and yet they were more than willing to make it appear that the Rosenbergs stole the secret of the A-bomb.
Ethel Rosenberg was put to death as a co-conspirator with her husband, Julius. The only act she was said to have committed was the typing of the so-called atomic secrets. Ethel Rosenberg did indeed own a typewriter. This is that very same machine. But the files and an interview Arthur Radosh had with the Greenglasses now seem to suggest that Ethel may have been convicted on the basis of a story invented by the Greenglasses and the prosecutors. Ron Radosh.
We had the opportunity of meeting and talking with David and Ruth Greenglass on three different occasions. It was clear from our conversations with them, as well as careful reading of their FBI interrogations, that one of the elements of their story, and their main story had remained consistent throughout the months of interrogation, that one element of their story was untrue. And this was the allegation made at the trial by the Greenglasses that Ethel Rosenberg, Julius's wife, had typed the material David had prepared to give to the Russians. Typed it supposedly because his handwriting was not particularly legible. We found indeed that his handwriting was legible, and the dramatic change in story that we uncovered, that is in the FBI files, is that they only developed the story of the typing 10 brief days before the trial. If that new story had not been given to the government, Ethel Rosenberg could not have even been indicted because they had nothing to accuse of her of in terms of any kind of overt act whatsoever. Talking to the Greenglasses made clear to us that they did not even remember the story. They were shocked by the realization.
And the reason for this is that we want to use her as a lever to force Julius to break and to tell what he knows.
David and Ruth Greenglass, the admitted Soviet agents, were portrayed as the helpless victims of the Rosenbergs. Historian Ron Radosh, having acquired their personal files and letters, draws another conclusion.
The files and the interview with them also uncovered that they were really more involved themselves on their own. They developed a strategy at the trial of trying to blame their involvement on Julius, an older brother-in-law, who they were essentially psychologically seduced by. This is phony because the Greenglasses' letters, their private correspondence, reveal a great awareness of espionage and an anxious willingness to participate in it of their own. These letters were kept out of the trial, even though they could have been used to prove espionage, because they would have portrayed the Greenglasses as much more involved and much less dependent on Julius than they were.
The heart of this case centered around the government's contention that the Rosenbergs were the head and center of an espionage ring. That may or may not have been so, But no evidence to support that view has ever come to light, nor was any introduced at the trial. The newly released files suggest the contention was based to a great extent upon the reports of an FBI informer placed by the government in a cell next to Rosenberg just before his trial. To historian Ron Radosh, the FBI Tartico files suggest confirmation of the super spy allegation.
We've concluded that Julius Rosenberg was involved in espionage for various reasons. One is the testimony appearing in the FBI files from a man who turned out to be a close confidant of Julius while he was awaiting trial and during the trial itself, a secret FBI informer named Jerome Eugene Tartico, to whom Julius began to reveal or brag about his espionage-related activities. He talked to Tartico, strange as it may seem, because Tartico had a common background. This was a man who was a low-level con man by everybody's observation, awaiting trial for a regular crime, but who, like Julius, was Jewish, had been a member of the Young Communist League, and whose mother was a communist. They shared that in common, and Julius soon began talking to him. The stories that Tartico gave the FBI, the specifics he related that he got from Julius, began to check out. For example, the last day of the trial, the FBI brought in a surprise witness, a passport photographer who took pictures of the Rosenbergs. They only began to look for this man, who was not even supposed to be a witness, was not on the witness list, because a few days earlier, Tartico had said to the FBI, Julius is happy that the FBI never found the passport photographer who took pictures of us. Evidently, the point being that Julius and his family were taking passport pictures because they were getting ready to flee the country. The FBI found that man in the Rosenberg's own neighborhood, brought him in, and he was the last surprise witness of the government. The government only looked for this man because they got the lead from Tartico. It had never occurred to them before.
In each and every case, when Tartico came up with something that seemed to correspond to fact, it turned out that this very same material was in the FBI file and was known to the FBI months, sometimes years, before Tartico told the story.
We found Tartico to be a credible witness because of the very concrete stories he gave about espionage activity involving many of Julius Rosenberg's long-standing friends and associates who he had known since the 1930s in City College.
6 or 5 years after all of this, the Department of Justice, under Brownell, decided that they would try to see if they could reopen the Rosenberg case, so to speak, by calling the grand jury and trying to build a case against people who were members of the so-called Rosenberg spy ring. And they went over all of the material, and they particularly went over all of Tartico's material. And the conclusion that the top officials of the Department of Justice reached was that 5 years later, they still labeled him an informant of unknown reliability and said that most of his material had been incapable of being corroborated in any way.
Although historians, journalists, and surviving participants reviewing the released files seem to differ on the degree of guilt or innocence, most seem to agree that the conduct of the government, its investigators, its prosecutors, its judges, left little for the rest of us to be proud of.
The Rosenberg case, and here we feel the critics are correct, revealed a sorry inadequacy in the state of American justice. It is true that if they were not tried on the conspiracy statute, it would, of course, have been much harder to get a conviction.
What do the files tell us about the principal crime of the Rosenbergs? We found that the files offer no hard new evidence on this aspect of the case, that the files have a great deal of information on FBI techniques of investigation, on all kinds of peripheral people, friends and associates of the Rosenbergs, but really no hard evidence of espionage.
The treatment of the co-defendant, Morton Sobel, was scandalous. And his defense, and the position he took in the defense, not even testifying in the witness stand, did not do him any good. In fact, in a shocking memorandum, while J. Edgar Hoover said he hoped there would be no death sentence for Ethel and that he was against it, He said that he wanted and hoped there would be a death sentence against Morton Sobel because they had nothing against him.
I defy anyone who has read the files to point to any document and say, here it is. Here is real evidence of espionage. So I don't think there's any ambiguity about that.
We feel the trial and the case itself was a grave and sorry blot in the standard of American justice because, if I could put it bluntly, even spies have constitutional rights.
We have in this report simply skimmed the highlights of the newly released government files. It is important to note that although we now better understand who we were and what our government did that June evening 30 years ago, we may never know with any degree of certainty whether our rush to judgment was justified. Why, some may ask, need we continue to dredge up what seems to have been still another unsightly blotch on the pages of our history? The reason, now as it was when this examination was first broadcast, is best expressed by the poet-philosopher Santayana. Those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it.
I consider your crime worse than murder. I believe your conduct in putting into the hands of the Russians the A-bomb years before our best scientists predicted Russia would perfect the bomb has already caused, in my opinion, the communist aggression in Korea, with the resultant casualties exceeding 50,000. And who knows but that millions more of innocent people may pay the price of your treason. Indeed, by your betrayal, you undoubtedly have altered the course of history to the disadvantage of our country. We have evidence of your treachery all around us every day. The civilian defense activities throughout the nation are aimed at preparing us for an atom bomb attack. It is not in my power, Julius and Ethel Rosenberg, to forgive you. You are hereby sentenced to the punishment of death.